1 2 1 2 testing 1 2 3 1 2. Doesn't have a mic.
It's on its way.
Okay. 1 2 1 2.
You're good.
You're good. 1 2 1 2. Yes, just like
just check
that.
1 2 1 2 1 2.
1 2 3. Long.
Welcome to Reggae Open University. I mean, it's a big celebration of Jamaican reggae music. We love it. We are live from the Bob Marley Museum. And we thank Jaria for allowing us to have this amazing event in association with the Bob Marley Group of Companies. We're, of course, celebrating Bob 79. Happy birthday, Bob. And thank you for joining us for this amazing conversation about reggae music and art. And specifically, we're going to be talking about graphics. Graphics in reggae, graphics in music. thank you, my co-host, Taj.
All right, no problem. Yeah, so so the importance of graphics in music in general, because if you think about it, even before the advent of social media, before the advent of having easy access to things, if somebody go into a record store, somebody go and see a poster, them, even if they never hear the song before, the first thing that them see is that artwork. And then that brings that intrigue, and it's like, what is this? You know, where is this happening? Who is this? Whatever, you know, so that's like the first, a lot of the times, sometimes even to this day, that's the first point of entry for music for a lot of people, is seeing something that represents that artist or represents that event or that, you know, that particular sound, you know, so that's
because
why
we're
that's
visual separate. People.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
What we see then pulls us in to ask more questions. Thank you for that perspective. Farnight, what do you say?
I couldn't agree with him more. He said it perfectly, because you want to tell a story where music is usually giving you a feeling or telling some type of story. So the artwork now is helping you to create that picture, helping you to visualize that story. Like he said, I mean, I remember the first time, I didn't know about Jimi Hendrix, but I saw this poster of Jimi Hendrix painted by somebody, a German.
We used to use can spray and cut out paper to create a template, because we didn't have printing machines. Everything was tactile, everything was physical. And if you made an error in putting even the art of music a little bit on the left or right side of a page, you had to pull up each letter and put them back down again with a thing called wax. So the importance of graphics has always been integral. And though we had to import what we used to call them cherry types. We used to have to import the types from America, you know. So lettering, he was a fantastic letter writer. Fantastic letter writer. So the importance of it was our social media. But we didn't have social media, so people used to call the work that I did when I came in and saw Baga doing all that physical work. I mean, all that, you know, original art writing. Everything he did was original. Mine was like, they call it Hollywood. So I say, Hollywood? You're trying to bring Hollywood to the music? You know, and he can tell you. It was just something else.
We really appreciate that walk or jog down memory lane. Thank you so much for that perspective. And we're going to go to you, Bago, telling us about, you know, what your perspective is on that importance. He alluded to some of the work that you do, but please tell us, why is it so important, you know, for us to respect graphics and music?
Well, first of all, you have to sell the product. And it is very, very, very important, because as a graphic artist, you have to search and find the genre. You have to represent the genre. And we represent reggae music in Jamaica. And it had to add a look. It has to add that look, because I was lucky enough to grow with reggae music. It was very important. That first artwork in about 73, 74 for Gussie Clark. And from that, I walked into a studio one day, and I think it was Soldier, the engineer, said, "So what, Bugger Case?" And a white man jump up and said, "Wait, Bugger Case that? You know, when I look I come from Switzerland, you know, in his own language. I come from Switzerland, and when I look on the artwork, I just feel like I'm not Jamaica."
World renowned.
Thank you so much, Farnight.
I don't have to give thanks, you know, because I grew with reggae, and I was there. as a graphic artist. As I told you before, the first job I did was Leroy Smart, Get Smart, for Gussie Clark, you know? And that started me off. And after a while, I got very popular. Song. And I got it from Amali, because there was Kaya, on the back of Kaya album, I saw where there was a painting of a spliff, right? And the watercolor, smoke. It was that?
The smoke coming
out. Yes. And I saw the watercolor run into each other and form red, gold, and green, red, yellow, and green. And I said, that's a good idea. So I called Tomiko one. And I said, Tommy, I can't put red, gold, and green upon the job, and there's a black and white, but I can't lift it up, you know. And I said, that's a good idea. And it lasted for about 20 years. 20 years it lasted for, to express reggae album jacket, to express reggae album jacket using red, gold, and green. Yeah, but I just want to say it has been an astray. I don't remember the original question, but all I can say is that...
it's all about music and art and graphics, yes. So we're never straying.
Yes, and I'm proud to be a part of the Jamaica reggae music industry. As a singer and also a graphic artist.
We appreciate you so much. And Frankie Campbell said, you know, when you got that award from Jari in 2021, that he looks forward to seeing your work exhibited as art, your graphic design. So we're sending it out into the universe.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you so much.
We're sending it out into the universe. Yes. Thank you so much. I mean, Demario, we're gonna throw to you. You're known for your Sting posters, all about with its excitement. You've done Dennis Brown's Inseparable. You've also gotten the Peer Award, Graphic Designer Award in 2000. Talk to us about, you know, your work and what has inspired your journey.
My journey has been quite an interesting one. When I started working with Mike Tomlinson, and what's the name again? He was working at Babsy Grange also. Loy Grant. That was in, yes, corporate, right. That was, Bagger was the vinyl designer. And I went up there and met him one day also. I met Tommy Cohen, quite a few of those persons. I was going to Excelsior High School, so coming up to Old Hope Road intersection, walking across to where the 4-H Club is now, that's the little place I called home, because a lot of persons were nestled in that area, dealing with Mike Tomlinson, booking and PR and so on, so it gave me a good place to start doing small flyers. I had to graduate to posters. Even when it came on to graduating to designing Sting posters, I'd wait until, well, as a founding director in 84, but I'd wait until 1987 to start dancing a poster, because Migos was there before me. Migos, who is Migos? Migos is the guy that created the 2x2 mini billboards. Why did we make mini billboards? Because there was no financing music to give us 8x4 boards, or matter of fact, those 21x10s, major billboard, so we said we had to find an innovative to design a poster. It was for the Sting poster. Created that genre, did the big the Fat Boys poster, and it made me a star. When I say a star, remember, we didn't have LinkedIn, we didn't have any social media. Just imagine nothing. And you create a big poster like that, full color, only could be printed at lithographic printers. When it was such a challenge that the boss of the company came on and asked me if I was sure what I was doing. Now, having done smaller ones before, 17 by 22s, to do a 38 by 25 was ridiculous. And the design held so well that one of the things that happened to me, which my parents didn't like, was that a lot of bad boys were calling me.
Oh, wow. We're gonna pause it at the bad boys, because we love good music and good vibes. But we really appreciate you, Journey. We thank you so much for sharing that with us. I'm going to go right to my left, Farnight. And, you know, you have a lot of talents. Musician, designer. Like, talk to us about your...
Savage Crew logo that was in Ligony, where the KFC headquarters is right now. I mean, me and a couple of friends did it like at 3 a.m. We could have definitely, well, we did get in trouble for it and had to paint over the wall and stuff. But it started as early as the breakdancing days. I used to, just like my friend here, Demar, used to design a lot of flyers for the early Renaissance parties. David Muir, Sparkles, and as well as his wife Colette, you know. I used to buy jewelry from her, and she used to always have nice artifacts coming in from Brazil. And Neville was the original one that influenced me to want to be a graphic artist. You know, he was already doing spectacular Bob Marley album covers. If you know Bob Marley album covers, they're spectacular. They actually gave you a feeling when you looked at them. One of my final year pieces of Edna was the uprising one. Bob's Coming Out of the Roots, which I totally jacked from Neville, you know, big up. But he spoke to me, I think Neville used to go to UCLA, where he studied graphics. And he impressed upon me that, listen, you can do many things. Don't get pigeonholed, you know. You know, you're doing, you know, you at the time I was good at fine art as well. You know, don't think you can just do fine art alone, get into painting if you can, or even graphics if you can, you know. Or I was actually getting into music at the time when he was having these discussions with me, but that was my introduction, as I would say. So, yeah, enough said.
And I mean, I appreciate it. And what I've been seeing is the connection with music and graphics, and it's the entire visual design. It's all the visual arts, and it's how you've all been able to translate your love of music, your love of reggae, your love of Jamaica authentically into these visuals that bring people into the music. They see it before they hear it. So I just want to say big respects and thank you so much for sharing your journey with us visually. It really has enhanced how we experience the music. And Taj, I'm going to bring you into this conversation because I know you have also worked on a lot of different illustrations for, you know, music covers, for vinyl covers. Talk to us about your journey. What has inspired you to enter the space in that way, and especially your relationship with graphics and music? What has that been like for you?
Well, first, I'd like to thank you guys for sharing your story. It was very inspirational. But yeah, my story started with graphic design, first and foremost. My story started in high school. I used to be a part of a crew of people in my high school called Deadline Sound. And used to do little DJing at different things. And I used to be the graphic designer of the group because I was the person who drew and whatever. I was like, all right, well, I'll just do all the posters and all the, you know, event flyers and the little mix cover CDs. So that was like my first like exploration into the space, until then I was going to UTEC to the architecture because parents say, oh, I mean, the graphics, you know, maybe, yeah. And then, so.
No respect, eh? Yeah, like you were saying.
No respect, so.
But we're getting there.
That fell out. That didn't happen. So then I just said, all right, well, I'm just going to go Edna. And just, you know, my uncle, who also worked in graphic design at the time, he was like, yeah, man, just go Edna. Just, you know, just try. Just check. Just go. Even if it's just 1 year, just go Edna. See what you can do. And, yeah, I just loved it. And from there, by the time I reached second year, I used to do this thing where I used to paint on people's shoes. So I used to do like graphic design on people's shoes. So I get leather paint, clean off the finish off of the shoes, and paint like different things. I paint reggae artists, music.
We are celebrating reggae music. Jaria, in association with the Bob Marley Group of Companies, we're of course celebrating Love 79. And we're talking about the importance of graphics in music. When you see the vinyls, when you see those covers, it pulls you into the music. And we've been sharing a journey with my wonderful guest here. And right before the break, we said we're going to come back and talk about what has been that love. Have you been receiving or feeling the love from others for the real value of graphics in music? I'm going to start with you, Baga Case.
Well, as I said before, I don't think we're really respected. You know, because would you believe this, that Neville is the first graphic artist who got an OD? Neville Garrick is the first graphic artist to get that. And we have some wonderful graphic artists in Jamaica. Great graphic artists. See, my brethren? Okay. I was a graphic artist who did everything, but I majored in reggae, the reggae album designs, right? Because I do everything, photography and everything, and other designs and newspaper designs, but I spent a lot of time doing those reggae things because sometimes I would do 5 a week. Would you believe it? It's not easy. It is not easy to do 5 designs a week, you know. Come, I remember once I did something about a chocolate design. A lot of time the client wanted to do what he wants. But you as a graphic artist, when you get the name of the album, you can say this is the right design for this jacket. But the producer and the own executive producer wants you to design what he has in his head. And he's not a graphic artist, so we're not really respected sometimes.
So it's respect for the art and respect for the artist is what's needed in the industry. We thank you so much for sharing that perspective. I'm going to bring you in, Taj, as, shall I call you a young designer in the space? I mean, you've been doing such big things. I don't even know if young is the correct phrase. But talk to us about your thoughts on that. Considering your journey through doing design for music and so on, what has that been like for you? What has been your experience and the respect and love that's shown to the artist, the graphic artist?
Well, I'd have to agree with Baga. I think that there is, people say you said you're a graphic designer to somebody, they have more of an idea of what that is now, maybe giving your creative energy to this thing, and someone's like, oh no, I think you should do this instead. And it's like, but imagine how much more further this could go and how much more further this could be respected if these creative ideas get a chance to be seen and be shown. You know, I feel like it's important for the survival of the culture and of the visual aspect of it, as well as just music in general, you know, for that to happen.
And I'm gonna come back to you to ask you about, you know, where do you see it going? And I'm gonna throw that around to my fellow guest as well. But I'm gonna go to you, Fahrenheit, on the angle of how do we move from here? How do we move from the position of this lower level of respect for graphic designers to a point where there is as much respect for the work of the artwork we're seeing and the music that it represents? What do you think is the next step?
Like he just said, the platform is fairly new, not the graphic art platform, but just the understanding of what goes along with graphics. And then again, graphics over time has moved really rapidly in terms of, he mentioned something very important in Jamaican, and still important in Jamaican, advertising of events in 2x2 boards. 2x2 boards is a thing that somebody had to think of creatively, like, okay, we can't afford those big, what's a big billboard size? Yeah, it was Air Jamaica and Panama and pay for those kind of things, right? But they now have to innovatively think of things to do for that, not just the street cred, but to get the marketability out there. And it's so very powerful. It worked when they did that. I grew up on, I'm sorry to kind of stray, but it kind of tallies to the bigger point. I grew up on a lot of Baga Case's work as well. It's so cutting edge for you to include red, green, and gold now on a lot of things that you weren't before, because it just continues to cut through and work. So people now, coming back to your original question, where do we go from here? People are now becoming more understanding of the platform of graphics. Like you just said, when somebody said, well, you know, I'm opening a business and I want my logo to design that.
Yes.
He didn't love him daughter.
True.
AZ car rental, and it's just like, wow, an A and a Z. You know what I'm saying? As a big, right. So you,
but you see the story in the art. You can tell an artist thought about that, pulled it together.
The respect, that's where you have to kind of give the respect. Because when you can look at a logo, and you can look and really feel a story coming out of it or depict. When you look at the KFC logo, you get what the kernel is about. When you look at the Wendy's logo, when you look at all these very big global designs, you know, as simple as Shell. Shell doesn't even have to put S-H-E-L-L beside the actual Shell that they have a company in their logo, because the logo is just so powerful. And I know it's a gasoline, but I know that's what represents them.
Absolutely. And as we've been also talking about events, a lot of times when you see a poster, it helps you to decide whether you're going to go or not.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, I've personally seen posters and I said, this looks like my vibe. I don't know these DJs, but this looks like my vibe.
Right, exactly. I have a weekly event that's happening at Jangas, for instance, every Wednesday. It's an Afrobeats event. And even today, I had arguments with someone who is producing some artwork for me. And in just the look of it, I love dancehall events, don't get me wrong, but it just did look like a hardcore dancehall event. And that's not what it is. You know what I'm saying? So I'm like, no, you have to switch up that and give it, go back in the Afrocentric feel and give it something. We're coming, you know what I'm saying? So it's very important when you see people transcending a message, giving you a message that's clear. Somebody had to really put thought and design it to make it clear, you know? And that's where you ask where I see it going. It's just that respect level is there. And you have people that are doing good work now, like this young gentleman. I didn't even know that you were doing those Protégé projects, which I was actually admiring.
Yeah, so the, from a distance. Yeah, the first... about 3-4 albums. Yeah.
Awesome. I know them, and I didn't know you're doing them, so congratulations for that.
Thank you.
So there's the respect right there moving forward.
Look at the love.
Yeah, man.
Look at the love. We love it. And, you know, the essence of this conversation is showing respect for the work that you have been doing, that you have been adding to the music. I'm going to go to you to comment from what Fahrenheit spoke about in Where Next Do We Go? Give us, you know, a brief thought on what are some other ways in which we can continue to show respect for the artists, because they are very integral in the process of the music industry.
You said artist, and for a moment I was thinking artiste. But
there
but
you go. Yes. See? So yes. We're going to have to probably switch the thought. When I say artist, I'm talking to the two of them. Whoever is singing, whoever is creating those visuals for
yes.
you.
Yes. But to remain in integrity with your creatives in this creative space, we've got to really know, give more thought, not us, but our client base, our canvas out there, our world, to what it is that we put out. A lot of us, like Baga K said, spend a lot of time developing a product. And as soon as you've developed the look and the brand, in our days, we didn't know about image building. We didn't know those phrases, you know. We knew about coming up with a nice logo that is integratable. So you can make it small for business card, you can make it large for the name of the show, you can put it on TV and so on. But we didn't know about image building, brand building, we didn't know about those little nuances. What we knew is that when we designed a poster, for example, and completed it, we couldn't pass Crossroads with it. You never know that. But posters.
Thanks for letting me know.
You couldn't pass Crossroads with a poster. Remember, you was working at Trevanion Park where that designer.
What do you mean by that? I don't get that. What do you mean?
You couldn't pass Crossroads. You couldn't put up a poster on the street above Crossroads, because that was like a downtown kind of thing. So Leng was the one that had caused juggling. You know juggling? We used to juggling. He used to put and have the board in front. He was locked up many nights. Many nights I had to go and bail him, right? Because you're torn with those kind of things. When I look everywhere and see boards, posters on walls, my Sting poster on wall, Fresh poster, Reggae My Light, it's Ram Jam, all those things, they couldn't pass Crossroads.
That's an interesting perspective.
I didn't know this.
Yes,
absolutely. And you know what I want?
Because it was littering.
Littering, okay.
So MPM would have taken it down from his uptown, you mean?
MPM never met them times.
So who was responsible for removing them?
KCAC and different MPM, people.
Yes,
like
yes,
those.
I mean KCAC.
So what I'm saying is, we have been through a lot. You know, Bob would say he wasn't financed. But people said that there was difficulty for you to find finance for studio hours to properly produce music. Right. When we produce a nice flyer, there was no place to put it for visual depiction. One of the things that I also said a lot of people have missed in this is that lot of the graphics for outdoors were done by people who were at sign companies, who used to work and do the state karate, martial arts, Shaolin Monk, Enter the Dragon. Those are the people that were doing the big visuals, you know. So when he was doing when Baga, my big brother, was doing LPs and 45s and the disco 45s, and then he do posters, I came up with the idea to make the version between what's on State Wall, Enter the Dragon, Shaolin Monk, you know, exactly, the side between that and posters. So that's why I came up with the 38 by 25. But now to make it pretty, and they call it a Hollywood type, to make it transitional now, to take it into a kind of America kind of vibe, and then do color separations. I had to go to America to get color separations. For lithographic alone was, yes, you know, it was so difficult.
I want to move us to...
I experienced racism.
Before you go, what I want to move us to, as you're mentioning that, is the evolution of our designs, and you know how it has kind of moved through the time in terms of how it looks. I'm getting a wrap, so we're going to go to the break. It's been such an exciting conversation. Stick and stay with us. This is Reggae Open University. We'll be right back.
We'll be right back.
Welcome back to Reggae Open University. We are talking about the evolution of music. We're talking about graphic designing music, why it's important. I'm so grateful to my panelists for sharing with me their own journey in music and the love and respect that we need to have for it. Thank you so much for sharing or your energy with us. And of course, we want to say a big shout out to our sponsors. It's a long list. Stick and stay with me. We have the Chase Fund, J. Ray and Nephew, Urban Development Corporation. We also have Tourism Enhancement Fund, the Ministry of Culture, Gender, Entertainment and Sport, JCDC, SEROM, VM Wealth Management, Sun City, Spur Open. We also have One Love 79, the Bob Marley Museum, PBC Jamaica, S Hotel, Key Mix, So Creative, Juicy Patties, iPrint, Rhythm FM, Phase 3 Productions, and we also have Music and Entertainment Factory. We also have other sponsors. We'll come right back to them. But we thank you so much for this amazing event and conversation about the importance of graphics in music. Before we went to the break, I threw out the question of what has the evolution of these visual designs been? And Baga Case, you wanted to comment on that from your perspective and journey, and we appreciate your thoughts.
Okay, I hope I can remember the question, because I just want to say something. I just want to big up Jaria. Big up Jaria.
Yes,
for,
most definitely.
Yes, because they gave me an award recently. And the Jamaica Federation of Musicians, who gave me the same award years ago. I just want to say thank you for remembering us. Album jacket or whatever it is. Nowadays, it's just a little square. And for upload. But it's the same process, it's the same amount of time to do it. I don't understand what used to take place, because now and then, like a Carlene Davis album jacket, she would do a photo shoot, you know? A couple of people would do that. But most of the times, we didn't have that. We didn't have a photo shoot. We didn't have, it's just, nobody knew what to do. Oh, you come to me to do a graphic, an album jacket. Give me all the necessary information to go on the album jacket. Give me all the necessary information so that the artist can collect his royalties over the years. Nothing was done. No writer for the songs and all them things. I had to fight. But like Gussie and people like those who are publishers would carry everything to me, and I can do a good album jacket. Until VP came into the process, came into the picture, and they would send everything to me. They would send everything to me and find it hard to get all the information from the producers too. Because when you look on the American and so-called and the American graphics and all them types of Michael Jackson album, you know that work was put into it. They were brilliant because everything was and offered to the graphic artists. And we had to, sometimes I had to do the liner notes for the graphic art. No liner notes or anything. And as a graphic artist, I want to listen to what the singer is singing. I need to know what the singer is singing so I can design for the singer. That was very important to me, and I'd never get nothing. Some of them are, because I'm a singer, I know about the person. I know about the person I'm doing up, so I do some work with what I know of the person. And just do overnight after I do this quick album jacket. Sometimes it wasn't easy at all, but we love it same way. We love it same way. Give thanks for the journey.
And we really appreciate it. As I was saying earlier, when I say artist, I want you to think about the artist who is making the music, but the artist who is creating that visual representation of what that music stands for, what it wants you to feel when you see it. And I'm going to throw to you, Taj, because we're talking about the evolution of graphics in music. We've seen it starting somewhere. We've seen it change. But then we're also seeing this fusion of, we could say, old and new coming together. What are you doing as you continue to be in this space?
You know, it's funny. I feel like, because even when you were referencing drawing.
One more, let's get together and feel all right. You're the children
radio, Siri.
Yeah, you know, so something to watch out for. You might notice that a lot of things not
one love. So,
like, everything's not working.
One love.
Even if there was a
let's
time where maybe
get together and feel alright. Hear the children crying.
Where you feel like your thing looks like everyone else's thing and not specifically a reggae Jamaican thing in this context at least.
And I appreciate that thought, because where it takes us is, and I'm going to go to you Fahrenheit, is as we evolve in the music and the visual representation of that through the arts and the graphics, how do we ensure that we are remaining authentically Jamaican and who we are while considering that there are all these other influences, out of many one people, of course, but how do we make sure, as we represent these things visually, that we're remaining authentic?
We just have to continue to be our true selves and draw back from, like what he just says, the things that are just here and available and that strike that true note. Like, as he says, things have a cycle. Like, for example, there was a time when most album jackets or designing for reggae posters, or especially album jackets, used to be this kind of glamour photography type of vibe. Everybody was into this glamour photo, like how Michael posed on the album of Thriller. And then it came out of that type of design style to another style of being a caricature. I remember a lot of the Leaf Scratch Perry records used to be illustrative. That works. You know, especially in the reggae genre, you don't really want to bend to, even though it's interesting when people kind of think outside of the box sometimes. I remember, I don't know if you designed this album cover, Circle Still, because he was kind of like too outside of the box. Like, because, you know, Stanley
naked
was always...
Naked on a horse.
Yeah, it's a bit too outside of the box for reggae. You know, come back to the center. So like as he's saying, work with what you know work. Work with what's there. Work with what's available. Boom.
Well, can I come?
Absolutely.
Well, I can't identify a Jamaican designer no more. The only thing I know the artist is a Jamaican. But we don't have a design that to say that this comes from Jamaica without knowing the artist. And we need to go back to that.
Wow, that's
like when you used to see all the third world album covers.
Yeah, with that boat.
With as type of drawing, I don't know.
Yes, that the boat that carrots said, boy, the boat will never reach Africa. He said the boat will never reach Africa, but that was good. I like that. There was a guy named Limonius. No, this is a bad time for me, you know. That is a bad time for me. Limonius, my brethren, still, you know, a good graphic artist, but he used to do some cartoon thing, very strange and. People think it's me do it. When I got the Jaria Award thing, I saw some Limonious artwork up there saying it's me do it.
We're gonna come back to it, and I don't want us to end on no.
Thank you.
is?
Haile Selassie I the first. Well, my name is Ross Isachar. I have a program on Roots FM that is called Till Morning Come. Two programs, and one is Poetry Jam every Monday from 6 until 8. And Till Morning Come is from midnight until 6 Saturday morning. Well, my question is not really a question. And I mean, this is a great symposium. But what I realize is that I don't see a lot of artists inside here. And I don't know why. But my next thing is, to me, one of the greatest graphic artists that I have ever known in my life is Ras Daniel Artman. Me, 79 is like 7 and 9 becomes what? Do the maths. 16.
Help us 16. Out here.
You understand me? I see I'm going to come, I'm going to look outside, I give thanks. Because you know why I give thanks? I see a lot of youngsters. And all of them is like a band, you see, and you see guitar, you see musician. So I know, say, the thing is growing. And I respect coming inside here and seeing this panel. Respect.
Give thanks
respect
every
man,
time.
Give thanks, man. And Daniel
so can I
Artman.
Ask you a question? It's a question that you asked that we're not talking about Ras Daniel Artman. It's
not
a question.
Saying you're not talking about him, but he's really being mentioned.
Because he wasn't a graphic artist, really, you know.
Okay, you tell
he was
me.
A fine artist.
A fine
he was
artist.
An illustrator, like, you know. Yeah. You know, artist.
Excellent.
Okay.
Excellent. Okay. Excellent. Because I'm a brethren too, you know. You know that.
My God, years you're coming up, man. I just know about
Ross, I'm a brethren.
Of course. But with respect, yeah.
But if we should delve into some other unmentioned persons. Paul Aitken.
Paul
Aitken.
Yes.
Fantastic, we have a lot of graphic art.
When I went off and started doing reggae graphics,
yeah,
it was totally controversial because apart from, oh my gosh, the guy who also drew a fantastic portrait of Bob Marley.
You're talking
I don't remember his name.
Neville Garrick?
No, not Neville, man. Oh. Neville's brethren. But he's a brown guy, almost like a Fahrenheit. But he was a fantastic portraiture artist, right? But he, out of art school, he said to me, if you want to go and design that, I don't know where you're going to live. Because we weren't being paid, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then I used this as a point of departure to get back to the point of content provision.
True.
Where photographs, you can't leave out Horseman. Horseman Pictures, a guy named Murphy. A lot of people like those who used to provide us with pictures. Now you Google. Mm-hmm. What? You had to wait 3-4 days for someone to come back from Negril.
Of course.
Where he's photographing people in the hotels because he got a little gig to shoot to shoot, and that's like 30-odd years. When I looked at it this morning, I laughed to myself because we had to use a thing called bromides. When you want to reproduce a black and white, you have to go to Gleaner Company and let Gleaner shoot that picture for you, and they would charge you for the acetate. You'd never recognize him. A little curly hair, cool looking baby, right down there. I think he was probably about 11, right? But you need to look at that poster. It's on Mr. Halliburton's arm.
You know, you've been taking us through a time capsule of technology as well, as to where we started, you having to physically put those on the wall. Remind us of the name of it again. Technique that you had to use.
Bromides. They're bromides. So I looked on this a while ago and saw that that there's a cutaway of you. How did we get that? If we shot a picture of you here today with you next to, we'd have to look at the picture and say, okay, the artwork needs to be this, needs to be a 70 by 22, we need to have you. Artwork needs to be this, needs to be a 70 by 22, we need to have you 4 inches tall. The picture have you 1/2 inch. How do we get it up? We have to physically work out how we do it. Sometimes you step it. So you're one of the persons using it. Because of what? Weekend Inquirer newspaper. Because of what? The Pure Class magazine. So what you see coming out 88, 89, 90, 91, it was incredible. 91, it was incredible. Doing like Boot Stewart, center spread, doing stuff for Chris's wife. What's her name again? The first supermodel. doing those ladies' center spreads ridiculous, and then mixing it with reggae, a lot of that reggae content, Admiral Bailey center spread. We're doing a lot of, it was such a fun, it's exhilarating thing. So I really appreciate the fact that these young men like Taj now are enduring with the speed of light technology they have and the access to Shutterstock and all those things. The fact that we, and you have to put Fire Knight in there because he was not all digital.
Of convenience, as usual, you know, so we don't necessarily, so now with computers and tablets and all these things, you don't necessarily have to go through all of the tough kind of longer processes of, as you when you're saying, waiting on plates, waiting on color separations for weeks. Yeah, you know, so, you know, now, especially because everything now moves so much faster. Like, if you think about it, music releases so much faster, shows, everything, all of this pace without all of this technology, without everything else is going. But there is something so important about that history and those, like, past techniques that should not be lost, even if it is in a situation where to understand how that works, or even hearing this and understanding how that works, that gives you some perspective, tactile texture and visuals that you can't get just from a computer. You can't get from that, you know, clean slate.
And before we go to, I mean, we're also going to be doing a tribute to the great Neville Garrick. And before we go straight into that, I briefly want to hear from you, Fire Knight, how you've been able to, having appreciating this foundation of where it started, and then having access to this new digital age of creating, how have those complemented each other in helping you to, you know, create what you do?
You know, to be honest, over the years, right, when I started doing graphics, it was very hardcore, rudimental. Calligraphy, everything by hand. There was no social media space. There was no computer designing. It was just computer graphics was just coming in when I was in graphics school at Edna, yeah? But over the time, when staying as a designer, I actually, sadly, never grasped any of the programs that were out there. I still can't function Adobe well. I know what I want in my mind. I can sketch something down very well for somebody who can manipulate a brand new program in Adobe Photoshop, say, okay, use that, okay, drop a foundation to know that you want this photograph katakana to the left, or you want it front and center, or do you want the focal to be a sepia tone or whatever. You still have that in your mind, I believe. That's how I design anyway. I can see it in my, yeah, you can see it in your mind first before you're putting it down on paper, so you know what you're going after. Yeah.
I appreciate that, and thank you so much for that perspective. And in the spirit of recognizing those who have done really great work in this space, all of you have been sharing, you've been doing a thing, and we respect you. Enough love to you. Thank you so much for keep doing it in spite of the challenges that you have faced and continue to face in the space. We appreciate the work that you continue to put in. And at this time, we definitely want to give a special tribute to Neville Garrick, who has given, you know, he's done great work in the space. He's a Jamaican graphic artist and visual designer renowned for his extraordinary contribution to the world of music and art. He's most recognized for his award-winning work as art director for Bob Marley, creating timeless artworks and designs that are still being recognized today. And his first
to work with Bob for the first tour in 1975, Natty Dread tour, I took it along as the backdrop. So, you know, Garvey was the first backdrop.
To win the world best designs. I want to hear from you, you know, all of you, the impact of the work of Neville Garrick on your own personal journeys. I think it's appropriate we start with you, Bagger Case.
Okay, let me tell you that Neville was my big brother in the business. Demar mentioned Cherry Types. That's where we met, because we were buying types to put on album jackets and things. In those days, you'll have to, we were pace-up artists. You know what's a pace-up artist?
This is history school, you know, and we love it here, so
a pace-up artist is a person who, when on his table, he's just like an architect. He has his T-square and his set square and everything, and his rubber cement. you put the rubber cement on the back of the thing, or the wax. Your wax is in a wax machine. And you start from a white sheet of paper. Then you put everything on it. And then what DeMario was talking about, he's talking about his experience. You know, Payo, I wanted to do this, and we started to work together. We started to work together on the Sunsplash. But it was an album jacket for Carl Peterson, which is Horseman's brother. He was an engineer for Bob Marley. And I couldn't read it because what it was placed. But when he told me what it was, I saw it. I saw that. I said, that's great. Neville, that's a great design. He was such an inspiration to me. Certainly was an inspiration to me. And there's one particular thing that he does. Never used to use paint like we know. He used to get the color from crayons. He used to wet up the crayon with his brush and paint. I don't think he's the one who illustrated that thing in it. It was illustrated. He got the illustration from somebody. But in his illustration, he means get it from crayons, the color, so that it would be different from other illustrations. It was fantastic.
Wow. I mean, I feel cozy inside getting down memory lane, and just the love and appreciation that we have for the foundation of graphics in relation to music. It's just so magical and just so important. Taj, I'm going to go to you because I want to hear, you know, has there been any impact on your own personal journey by, you know, observing the work that Neville Garrick has done throughout music? Has there been any impact on you?
Well, I mean, I've always been familiar with his work growing up, you know, seeing his vinyls. I had uncles and my parents who had some of the original artworks. But I remember going to, I think this was during Edna, I remember going down to the museum downtown, and they had like a exhibition of his artworks, several album artworks from that time period. But I remember just seeing like those artworks on those vinyls, like some of the original vinyls, because they have people who collected them in person. And it was definitely one of those like life-changing moments, because it was one of those things where, coming up now, at my age at the time when people were doing albums, I wasn't really so used to seeing artworks that look like that anymore. And going to that exhibition and seeing those works as they were in its original form just gave me a level of inspiration that I don't think I've ever experienced before up until that point, in terms of seeing like Jamaican graphic design and Jamaican like illustration for music, for reggae. It definitely was like
The journey of Neville Garrick and, you know, how it has impacted you as a designer.
Well, like I mentioned earlier, I met Neville in the business almost casually. I can't remember exactly what the occasion was where I met him, but what I do remember, you know, sometimes you don't remember what somebody said to you, but you remember how somebody make you feel. And as a young artist, and I was just coming out of Edna, so I was doing graphics around town, and I told him that, but he knew me as a young singer. I was just coming on the scene as a singer. And in Jamaica have this style where, you see, if you're doing something, people want to see you do that thing. They don't want to see you, what are you doing, singing, or you're acting, or you're doing graphics?
That's true.
Neville
was the first.
We have the same experience.
All, yeah, man. Three of us, I've had that experience all of my life. All of my life I've had this experience. And Neville was the first star, was the first classically trained person who came and said, yo, don't afraid to expand on your boundaries. I know you as a singer, Fire 90 name, don't, and I'm like, yeah, I'm like, I used to go, and he said, you used to go Edna? And I was like, yeah, I was aspiring to go to UCLA. I couldn't afford it. But he was like, listen, man, is me, you used to go Andrews and Immaculate Fett with the rest of his crew of five dudes to go break dance on the stage. So coming out of a dancing background to going to leaving Woolman's, being like, daddy, I don't really want to go to UWE. Well, if you're going to stay in this house, you better stay in the tertiary. I'm like, all right, I'm going to go to art school because I can draw. And so art school, going into music and all of it. So Neville kind of made me feel secure in that decision, and I'm happy about that because I'm still doing all of it.
And we respect it and we love it. Thank you so much for sharing your experience with us. You could tell us briefly, because we're gonna just kind of, you know, wrap into what's next? I'm going to, after take you briefly, I'm going to go to you, Taj. I know you have your exhibition coming up. You can briefly tell us about that. And then the rest of us can say, you know, what's next for us as artists? And remember, when I say artist, I'm talking about the visual designer first and then the musician after. Let's go, DeMario.
Well, it's good that Fahrenheit and Bagger Keys just touched on. All in here, we switched back. We switched and said, I think B really communicated. Never communicated on it. He called me, commented, he called me, said, you know, I saw your work, and I think it's such a brilliant masterstroke to try and create brand awareness. Somebody said, brand awareness? You don't know those big phrases, you know what I mean? Because it comes like UCLA in the fancy talk. But what I'm telling you, he never left me an inch, because he always found a way to call. Sometimes, I was trying to find a couple of emails today, and even the phone numbers and so on, because I met his daughter as a result of that. She's in PR now, yeah, way back in school. I'm telling you, Neville Garrick was incredible in terms of his influence.
We really appreciate, you know, the influence he has had on all of you here. Like, yeah. I feel like I knew him personally just by hearing your experiences. This has been such a great conversation, talking about the impact of graphics in music. I want us to wrap briefly, a couple seconds, just tell us briefly, Taj, about your new exhibition that's coming up, and then we'll just go around before we wrap this Reggae Open University.
Yeah, so, you know, so quickly, just speaking on the multitudes of graphic designers, I also do paintings and fine arts, so I have a fine arts exhibition coming up called The Night Sees. This is happening at 10 a.m. or on February 17th. It's running into March 1st.
So 10 a.m. West King's House?
Yeah, sorry?
10 a.m. West King's House.
Yeah, West King's House Road. 10 a.m. West King's House
Your
Road.
First solo exhibition in Jamaica.
Here in Jamaica, yeah.
Mad.
Yeah, so that'll be happening there.
This is graphic or fine arts?
Fine arts. Yeah.
What?
Yeah. So
interesting.
I'll also be doing like a live painting mural, because I also do mural live painting a mural at the space there as well, so people... During the run of the show, people can come and see that as well. So, yeah, that would be good. So that's 10 a West King's House Roads, February 17th to March 1st.
We're supporting that.
We're Thank all you. Leaving.
Yeah, everybody, February 17th, 10 a West King's House. Yeah.
There you go. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. This has been such a wonderful experience. This is Reggae Open University. Thank you to Jaria and, of course, the Bob Marley Museum, the Bob Marley Group of Companies. We are live from the Bob Marley Museum, celebrating reggae, celebrating music, and, of course, celebrating graphics. Thank you for staying with us. I'm Tavia Benjamin and my wonderful panel. I appreciate them so much for sharing their experience with us. Thank you for sticking around and continue to celebrate reggae music and the artists that make it possible.